I am so honored to introduce the 5th annual Bharat Shah Leadership Speaker Series, which was established at Georgia State Cecil B. Day School of Hospitality and the Robinson College of Business by Dr. Bharat Shah, a highly respected and well-renowned leader and philanthropist. As an immigrant to the United States, Dr. Shah's vision for this series was to share the intimate personal stories of our lodging and hospitality icons, whose diverse journeys of struggle, failure, perseverance, commitment, and faith have emboldened their pursuit of the American dream. The series has served as an inspiration to all of us, but particularly to our students, the future leaders of our industry. And I'm so very glad that we have so many students with us this afternoon. Bharat's son, Mitch Shah, is the CEO of Noble Investment Group, and over the years, he has brought us into the living room for candid conversations with his father, with Mark Elliott, president of Hodges, Ward & Elliott, with Mark Hoplamazian, CEO of Hyatt Hotels Corporation, and Tom Baltimore, chairman and CEO of Park Hotels and Resorts, and now Arne Sorenson, the president and chief executive officer of Marriott International, the largest hotel company in the world, which has 30 leading brands spanning 127 countries and generating more than $22 billion in annual revenues. Dr. and Mrs. Shah are with us today. I would like to ask them to stand to be recognized, along with Mitt's wife, Dr. Reshma Shah. Please stand and give them a round of applause. Thank you for being here. And for the very first time in conference history, we would like to welcome our audience watching on Facebook Live throughout the United States and around the world. On behalf of Georgia State University and the Hunter Hotel Conference, we are extremely proud to present the 5th annual Bharat Shah Leadership Speaker Series. Please join me in welcoming Arne Sorenson and Mitch Shah.
Thank you, Debbie, for that wonderful introduction, and Brother Arne, welcome.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Good to be here. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a good-looking crowd.
It's a great crowd, great hotel. So we have spent time talking over the years that one of the beautiful things about this country that we live in is that everybody comes from somewhere. And our families, all originated in different places and found our way here. I think what's especially interesting, Arne, about where you're from, is that it happened 150 years ago. And it actually happened in a geographic concentration. And much of the similarities about our cultures, although ours is a newer story, as you reminded me, is that we kind of migrated in places together and we helped each other out. So talk to us a little bit about that migration with your family and you know, coming over, and we'll get to your part a little bit about where you were born and the like, but you know, specifically around grandparents and what happened.
Yeah, it is an old story in some respects. My people came in 1870 roughly from Norway, not surprisingly given my name. And mostly they came to the Midwest, which you show here in darker colors because that's where all the Scandinavians came. And in part because they concentrated together, we retained a sense of our heritage. And so 20 years later when I was growing up, 110 years later, we would have Norwegian food for our celebratory meals. We had all these customs, eating even some things which were awful, lutefisk, which was a cod that's cured in lye, which was a tradition started by the Scandinavians before they had refrigeration. And it's awful. And in fact, nobody in the old country eats it.
Yeah.
But the Norwegians in the U.S. eat it because they don't realize that nobody in the old country eats it.
Right.
And a couple of stories here that are interesting. There's a part of this which is about how local things ultimately get. My great grandmother was born in a farm called Lia, L-I-A, New Year's Day 1851, I think. And near a town of Arendal, Norway. I went back with my family maybe a decade ago or so and walked in on a Saturday morning to the equivalent of a Radio Shack, you know, just a retail phone and electronic shop. And I asked the woman at the counter, I said, I'm looking for the farm Lia. This is 130 years later. And she said, go out here, go up the road, 10 miles, you'll see a bridge. Don't take that bridge. Go to the next bridge. It's a dirt bridge. Follow that around. Go up the hill, and you'll see the farm. This is, again, a name that's not published anywhere of a farm that's maybe 15 acres. It's not a palatial spread. Found the house that she was born in, knocked on the door, and in minutes we're having coffee with Norwegians living in that old house.
It's beautiful. So it's an incredible culture of support, and you know, as you think about what happened when your families migrated here, I think Luther College played an incredible role with both your grandparents and with yourself. Yeah. and also with your family. Talk a little bit about just that as a part of your family, four generations, the school itself, to really frame that community.
So we have across the United States hundreds of schools like this, started by churches typically, maybe sometimes with a particular flavor of an immigrant community. This is a Lutheran school, obviously, Luther College, not very subtle. And it was started to train teachers and preachers, also about 155 years ago, something like that. Little town in northeast corner of Iowa. Both of my grandfathers went to this school. One graduated in 1912 and one in 1920. My dad went to this school. I went to this school. One of my brothers went to this school. And my youngest son graduated last year. So we've got four generations who've gone through this place. And it is, of course, now a little less focused on teaching preachers than it was in the past and as a classic liberal arts school. But it is one that is sort of carrying on this tradition. When my grandfathers were there, it was all boys. It became co-ed, maybe 20 years after that, something like that. Many of the men, of course, served in World War I or World War II or Vietnam War as that was happening. And these are sort of classic American educational institutions. Great place for me to grow up.
Right. And so now, going back to your parents, and father was born in 1927, and in 1945, here we are, the Japanese surrender ends World War II.
Yep.
Dad's stationed in Japan at that time.
Right.
And comes back from Japan, arrives back in the United States. So walk us a little bit through that and then kind of the journey from there.
Yeah. So my dad signed up for service as a 17-year-old in 1945, got to Japan, thankfully, just after the war ended, stationed on a ship in Tokyo Harbor just for a year from 45 to 46. And I think fell in love with the place. It'd be obvious in a minute what the evidence of that is, but came back, went to college, like his father and my mother's father, became a Lutheran preacher, so he went to seminary after college, and met my mother last year of his seminary work, and they got married, and instantly they went back to Japan. And they spent 13 years in Japan, raising all of their kids, learning Japanese. My father read Japanese kanji. And it became the most important part, sort of our personal family story. But I'm always struck by two Midwesterners. My dad was born in Wisconsin, my mother in Nebraska, and little towns mostly. that they would, of course, he had this experience in the Army, but still to go from the Midwest to Japan in the early 50s is a pretty stunning kind of thing. It is an era when people didn't travel. We went back and forth by ship.
Right.
And my, there are some good things in this. There was no telephone or other, you know, practical way of live communication. So we have a letter a week from 13 years sent from my parents to their parents back in the upper Midwest, which is this sort of granular history of life in Tokyo. This is a picture of mostly members of Japanese Lutheran community. The little toe-headed guy in the middle is me. You know, for me, we left there when I was seven. While I have sort of Japanese memories, most of my memories are exactly the same of any seven-year-old kid anywhere.
Right.
You know, you remember the race you ran, you remember a broken bone maybe, you remember some, you know, fun, playful event. It wasn't a sort of a deep cultural conversation I was having as a six-year-old before coming back.
Sure, sure. But, you know, I think what's interesting, so you and all your siblings were born in Japan.
All born in Japan, yeah.
And, you know, even today, I think, you know, comfort food kind of is
give me some sushi.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And to think about that, just, and you know, that growing up, 7 years old in Japan, but then you came back to the U.S.
Yeah.
And, you know, that kind of journey back was a lot of the same in terms of the cultural experiences that, you know, you were, you know, you had the ability to kind of learn through your parents. So your father came back and immediately, you know, continued to, you know, fulfill his, you know, desires as a Lutheran minister.
Yeah.
Yeah. So talk about just growing up in Minnesota and just kind of what the house looked like.
Yeah. So we moved back to a, this gets a little more specific than you probably want, but we moved back to a little neighborhood in St. Paul, Minnesota, where there's a seminary called Luther Seminary. You get the overwhelming Lutheranness of this story. And the little Lutheran parish in this community we grew up in had 55 pastors as members because they were faculty at the seminary. So this is sort of deep Lutheran tradition. And that was a big part of who we were, but my dad remained involved in the church as a sort of world executive, overseeing missions and other things around the world. And so he was traveling around the world all the time and bringing people in from around the world all the time. And it made for a very, very sort of tight Midwestern community experience, but also a global flavor to it, which I think I remember sitting on the stairs as a, you know, 8-9 year old, not a big house, but listening to the conversation of these people from around the world talking about the political issues that were going on or church issues that were going on, and thinking then and sort of hearing back from him as he traveled about various parts of the world, and getting some curiosity about what was happening in the rest of the world.
So voluntary or involuntary, do we bring ourselves to Beirut?
Oh, look what you've done with this picture.
The picture on the right's the one that you took, right?
Yeah.
But it does resemble what Beirut looked like in 1979.
That is about an hour south of Beirut. I had been down there for a tour, and about 45 minutes after we left, it got shelled again. My dad had been, this is 1979, and my dad had been in Sicily the winter before, and he came back and he said, there's some people getting together in Beirut next summer, I think you should go. And I'll joke with my kids about this, I was 19 years old at the time. And I'll tell my kids, can you imagine if I came home and said, I think you should go to a war zone for the summer? But I was too young to really know any better, and it was an absolutely extraordinary summer. I flew, went to Europe first, and took a flight from Athens to Beirut, ultimately landed in Beirut. It was a classic, chaotic arrival. people all over the airport, you know, sort of fighting to find your bags. The drive from Beirut Airport to downtown Beirut, there were seven checkpoints, each controlled by a different militia. And Lebanon, I don't know how many have been there, but it's one of the most naturally beautiful parts of the world. As you're going from the airport with Mediterranean on your left, and you got the mountains with the cedars of Lebanon sort of rising on the right, skiing nearby. But for 5 miles, there was nothing but trash piled 6 or 7 stories high. This was a country that had been in war for 6 or 7 years. Gunfire every night. Every building was pockmarked. It didn't look like this everywhere, but there were signs of war literally everywhere. And it was as jarring an experience as you can imagine, like landing in a totally different place with totally different circumstances, and being with people who had lived through this and still had extraordinary hospitality, extraordinary optimism about the future, a zest for life, and it was just another great place to learn and grow up.
So we come back after 4 months, and Luther College, his home, religion major, and also was able to take some other business classes and the like, yep. Right? And then the decision to say, let's stay in the Midwest and go to law school. I know that, kind of when you think about this life that you've led of humanity, where born in Japan, having the ability to be around a lot of different cultures and different people, those 4 months that you spent in Beirut, law school is an interesting way in which to transition and then ultimately end up at Latham & Watkins as a litigator,
yep.
Right? So talk a little bit about the decision to be a litigator and what do you think that allowed you to, one, kind of step into that role and kind of what did you learn from that? Because as we go from here, this is really where the rest of this journey starts.
Yeah, so I went I graduated from college in 1980, and I wasn't blown away by any of the obvious jobs to take coming straight out of college. They just didn't seem inspiring to me somehow, and there wasn't a deep plan, but I thought, well, let me keep going to school and see what comes from that. Went to law school thinking it was a great training, and maybe I could do more than one career. With a law degree, but I went really never having met a lawyer, so I didn't have a deep sense of what to do. I also went to the University of Minnesota Law School, which at that time public education like schools like that was essentially free. I think it was $1,000 a year, literally, for tuition. That has sadly that story is gone today. But graduated from law school in 1983, and a pretty fortunate time to do it because big firms were hiring hand over fist, and I ended up spending summers in LA and New York working for law firms, but then getting married to my wife Ruth, and we sort of had this conversation about where should we move. She had never been to LA but didn't want to go. New York didn't feel quite right to us, and so we settled on Washington as a decent compromise. And so I went to Latham started there in the fall of 1984. And because I didn't really know that much about law, I figured I might as well be a trial lawyer as opposed to anything else that I didn't really understand. At least trial law, you can learn from watching Perry Mason.
Right, exactly. Well, lo and behold, so now I fast forward and you find yourself in a situation where you're representing a big company has to go figure out a new plan. And so take us through that time period. And, Marriott at the time had $3 billion of debt, $250 million of EBITDA. Steve Bollenbach was just brought back in as chief financial officer. So frame this time that I think for most of us, that have been in this industry for a while and the like, kind of remember that.
So this is important for the structure of the hotel business, really, and the structure of Marriott in many respects. In before 91, 91 is the first Gulf War, also a financial recession. Not long before that, the Japanese real estate investors have pulled out of acquiring in the United States. And all three of those forces combined to create a very tough environment for Marriott. Marriott's approach prior that, to that time had been, let's build our hotels on balance sheet. Let's then turn around and sell them to somebody else and retain a management contract. And obviously, there's no longer lived asset than a big urban hotel. Think of this Marriott Marquis, which you know is happening essentially in the same time frame. Unfortunately, the company had way too much construction in progress and debt associated with it. And B, the debt that was put in place was exactly the wrong debt for surviving a crisis. It was short-term callable debt. And so suddenly you get to a recession, the Japanese disappear, you got a Gulf War, operating conditions are not good, and there's nobody to buy these hotels. And so Marriott ends up with too much debt, too much real estate on the balance sheet, and a stock price which in today's terms is probably 20 cents, some number like that. Mr. Marriott famously walked the corridors of the Treasury Department at times wondering whether we'd make payroll. And so the company confronted that. Ultimately, Steve Bollenbach, who had been at Marriott before as treasurer, had left to go to Promis, sold Holiday Inns to Bass while he was there, left there and went to work for one Donald Trump. I don't know if anybody's heard that name or not. Donald Trump had his own bankruptcy threats at the time, and he was brought in essentially by the banks to be somebody to restructure the Trump organization. He got done with that in every sense, ready to move on to something else. And Marriott reached out, Bill Marriott reached out and said, why don't you come back and be CEO of Marriott? We could use your help. And so he comes in and has this is classic Steve Bollenbach. For those of you who know him will understand this, will probably know the story. But Steve was a brilliant deal maker with the idea. He wasn't very interested in doing the execution. Somebody else could deal with that. But his simple idea was, let's leave all these owned hotels and hotels under construction and all the debt in Marriott, and let's spin all the brands, the management business, the franchise business, the senior living business, the timeshare business, the food service business, everything else in a new company called Marriott International. The Marriott I work for is that Marriott International. The company that was left behind is Host Hotels. That was announced in the fall of 1992, ultimately completed in the fall of 1993. The day the deal was announced, the company was sued a dozen times. And to give you a sense how awful the environment was around this transaction, Merrill Lynch was Marriott's key advisor in putting this deal together. Merrill fired Marriott after the transaction was announced because the bondholding community basically said, if you continue to perpetrate this fraud on Marriott's debt holders, remember, imagine now you're a debt holder in the surviving company, credit's not nearly as good as what it would have been if the company was combined. The bondholders basically said, we'll never use your desk to trade bonds again. Merrill fired us. And it was on the cover of the Wall Street Journal, Merrill firing Marriott for a transaction which was unfair. That's my introduction to the company. Ultimately, it was the greatest thing to be involved in. Got to know Mr. Marriott well. He's a classic listening leader who was, of course, is the biggest thing that was going on at the time as far as Marriott was concerned. He would call his in-house general counsel, he would call Steve Bollenbach, the CFO, he would call the in-house person who managed litigation, but he'd often call me at home in the evening, and he'd ask everybody exactly the same questions. What happened today? What are we gonna do? Are we gonna renegotiate something? Where's this going? And through that, we developed a relationship that was obviously one of my still most important relationships in life.
I think what he said, there was an article in 2013 that he did with Harvard Business Review, and I think, you know, he characterized that time period, which was, he's the CEO, This is the most difficult situation that he's ever faced, and you had the ability in which to simplify the issues. This is a jury trial, and you had to prep him for a jury trial. Ultimately the outcome is known by all in that Marriott succeeded in one, but what was your takeaways from that jury trial in terms of how they thought about this case?
Yeah, we had it was a three-week trial in federal court in Baltimore. Jury of 12, a crusty old judge, Alexander Harvey, and put Bill Marriott on the stand, of course, put Steve Bolenbach on the stand, as well as a number of other folks. The judge later said Bill Marriott was the best witness he had ever seen. He was not quite as positive about Steve Bolenbach, and that really maybe because of the financial piece to it, I guess partly because of the personality. But ultimately, it was a simple case on one level. It was folks who had bought bonds issued by Marriott and were complaining about this transaction being unfair. Ultimately, the defense was fairly simple, which is the bonds have a contract. It's called an indenture. Yeah. Does your contract prohibit Marriott from doing this transaction? Crystal clear, it didn't. And so now ultimately for a jury to get comfortable with that defense, they need to understand where somebody's heart is, where the motives were, whether they were trying to do something that was really unfair. They don't care so much about the contract, but they're gonna try and understand, okay, what was motivating you? And that's why you go through all these witnesses who come on and say, no, this is where we were and this is where we were going, and we tried to structure it as carefully as we could in order to be fair. By the way, the bonds were all paid off. There was no economic loss. And again, you end up essentially telling a story, just as you do with these series. We all want to understand a story. That's what we try to do in that case.
So you now we're in a situation whereby Bill Marriott, you know, and this incredible family, and that's Debbie, you know, cutting the ribbon at the Key Bridge Marriott, and this deep-rooted family. Bill's father founded the business 90 years ago, and I think what's interesting is that, so for Bill and his father, you know, Bill was in 1964 when his father decided there was going to be a succession and a plan. There was, you know, he had a key executive that had been with him 20 years, brilliant financial mind and the like, and you know, Bill would remark that you know, he was only 34 years old at the time, 32, 34 years old. But it was his advisors, his father's advisors, that said that even though Bill didn't have this experience, he has the emotional quadrant, the people quadrant, that he actually could be the best leader. And so, you know, taking over that business and the toughest time that he'd ever felt in that business, and having you as someone that he could call every night and get him through it, I know that he felt incredibly loyal to, you know, to those that kind of support him that way. So then you get a call a couple years later from Bill, and he says what?
He says, why don't you come out and join the Marriott team, basically. Really brief call, so, you know, one of these evening calls, and he said, I'd love to have you come out here. I said, I'd be happy to come out, but not to be a lawyer. He said, you've hired me, I have a partner in a law firm downtown. If you want me as a lawyer, you can continue to hire me, but I'll come out if you want me to do something different. He said, okay. I said, okay, I'll come. And that was it. There was zero plan. I was an idiot in many respects to not say, okay, well, what's the job? Sort of basic questions.
Right.
But, you know, I had a relationship with him. And again, go back to when I went to law school, I was thinking, yeah, I can do a few different things. I had now been practicing law at Latham for 12 years at that point. And I was in a notorious trial when he called, which was the Haft family litigation. I don't know how many of you remember the Haft family, but they owned Dart Drug and Track Auto and Crown Books and a big real estate empire, and they had this internal family battle. This was a three-month trial in D.C. Superior Court. I was in the third month when Mr. Marriott called, and I was sort of ripe for the picking in the sense that it was great legal work, you know, TV cameras in front of the courthouse every day, great fees, you know, a high-profile trial. But it was worthless. We were accomplishing nothing other than watching a family self-destruct, basically. And so you didn't feel good about any of that. And so in that context, with the relationship I had with Marriott and with Mr. Marriott, and sort of seeing, yeah, okay, I'm doing something which is good work and I enjoyed it, but it was going to be more of the same in the future. Why not do something different?
So what was the job?
Well, I was in the law department, notwithstanding my comment, for about 8 weeks, and then got the M&A beat, so went off to try and acquire companies. We bought Renaissance fairly quickly in early 1997, so that was essentially the first deal that I did. And that job was a perfect way to learn the hotel business. Just, you know, for all of you who acquire hotels or build hotels, you see the same thing. And that is you're trying to figure out, okay, what's going to cost, what's the brand, what's the staffing model, where's the business going to come from. In the M&A context, it was that plus what would we do with that brand in our space? How would we structure our people organization to take that on and run it? What's the financial model, of course? How would we finance it? You know, what does it mean for our sort of growth strategies in the years ahead? And so I did that for a couple of years and spent a lot of time with Mr. Marriott. Jim Sullivan was then running development for us, and he was a fabulous teacher, absolutely fabulous teacher. And we sat together, looked at, you know, not only acquired Renaissance, but looked at acquiring Intercontinental, looked at acquiring Westin. Obviously two deals that we didn't do at that time, although we found a way to get Westin later.
Right. So then and then the next call that you get within Marriott is even completely different than the one that you had.
Yeah, so I'm traveling, I think in Japan, if I remember right, and call back to the office and my assistant says, Mr. Marriott called and wants to see you at his house on Saturday. Which, you know, is a fairly unusual sort of request. Got home, I think, from Japan on Friday. My wife said to me, what do you think this is about? I hope you're not going to get fired. And I said, I have no idea what this is about. But I went to his house that Saturday morning, and he explained that Mike Stein, the then CFO, was leaving the company, and he wanted me to be chief financial officer. Honestly, until that conversation, the idea of being the CFO of Marriott had never crossed my mind. It wasn't something I secretly pined for or had this ambition for. And what I said to Mr. Marriott was, you're crazy. I'm a lawyer. I'm not an accountant. I'm not, you know, you got all these people doing the control function and internal audit and all these other things. I don't know anything about any of it. He said, that's fine. You got a great team. You rely on that team, and I want you to be part of my team. And so I started that in October of 98, inauspiciously. The first day as CFO was our earnings release for the third quarter of 96.
And you never even
listened to an earnings call before. We open up the call. Mike Stein basically is there in the room, and he says, I want to introduce our new CFO, Arne Sorenson. He stands up and walks out. Now, of course, in there's a certain routine to this, although for the first one, never having been through it before, it didn't feel routine to me. But you've got these prepared comments, of course, and then the people on the phone, 100 or 200 people maybe, ask you questions about what's going on. We lost 10% of our value that day.
The ruble, the Russian ruble, Russian currency crisis literally happened on that day. The markets collapsed. Exactly.
And so we had company in the markets, but it wasn't one of those calls you leave the room and say, God, that went well.
Yeah. Yeah. First day on the job, lose 10% of the value of the stock, but. Talk about just kind of the journey from there.
Well, we did a call in February. It was my 78th straight quarterly earnings call. That's a big number. I think the only right response to that is get a life. How many of these can you really do? But I was then CFO for 10 or 12 years. We, of course, had boom times in the late 90s, as the industry did. You get to 2001, which we can talk about. You've got both Of course, the terrorist events, which are profound. But even before that, you've got a recession that begins. The third quarter of 2001, which for us ended on September 7th, 4 days before the events of 9/11, RevPAR was down 10%. So that's the base environment in which that horrible event happens. And we go through then, of course, a boom time, and then we go through another recession. And again, those are great learning experiences, and there were plenty of things that we didn't do well, either before that made us more exposed or maybe even during. But it was a chance to work with one of the industry's true icons, Bill Marriott, through this process and be involved in a company that's growing and be personally growing. Something there's not been a day I haven't enjoyed.
So if you think about Bill's own thoughts in terms of succession, and I know that you never really thought or considered kind of what was going to, you know, what happened, just knowing kind of your role in the business. And you know, Bill also, you know, similarly, he's you know, publicly said that, you know, much like his father did with him, he had you know, hoped that at some point in time, you know, one of his children would succeed him. And I think for, you know, there's so many family businesses that exist in our industry, and so many of the, you know, in this room itself. You know, that's a normal, rational thought. The name's on the door,
right.
And this is a scenario whereby Bill took over for his father, and you know, he certainly had kids. But what I found was interesting, just kind of in talking to him, and also seeing kind of how all this unfolded, is that ultimately what he was coming back to was this trust that was built up between the two of you, the organization was being created, and then basically recognizing that he had to do two things. One, what was best for his kids, but you know, also what was best for the company. And as he kind of morphed through all of that, your roles changed, and I know he intentionally made you president of Europe to give you some, I think in his own words, he would say, here's this great guy that, you know, was a litigator, and litigators don't necessarily always have the DNA of great, you know, people and
yep.
persons and leaders. So he wanted to, you know, to test that thesis. But I think what he came back to in terms of thinking about the opportunity for you and he to do something that was really transformational for the company, and yet also good for his family and his kids as shareholders and the like, came back to your background. And he's publicly said that he believes that your background with your parents, having this, you know, this faith that was deep in the company, but also having the ability to have known and embrace other cultures and other people, gave you a uniqueness to be able to think about this global business that, you know, he started with, that was $85 million of revenue, and when he transitioned as CEO to chairman in 2012, had $11 billion of revenues, that this was really the right person in which to go and lead. And I think, can you just maybe comment, because I know a lot of that are things that took place and happened, and you respect him so much for that. But just how did you think through that moment in time when you realized that today it's 90 years, at the time it was 85 years, there was only two CEOs of the business. And today there's now only three CEOs of a business that have been there for 90 years. And just that progression, and how perhaps unintentional, you go, I didn't have a plan, but how kind of, you know, intentional it became.
Yeah, it's, you know, this comment, you're the third Marriott CEO and the only one without the Marriott name. People say it over and over again, and it sounds, I don't know, like a huge deal. It's never really been that huge a deal for me. Why? Because this has been a gradual evolution. And I'm CEO of Marriott in part because Bill Marriott turned 80, and a new CEO had to be named. In part because the desires he had to have one of his sons step in was not right at the time, and in part because I was there. Because, you know, in 2012, we'd been working together at that point for 20 years. So, at least 6 or 7 years prior to that, I had been sort of publicly identified as a possible successor to him. And we've been working together through that whole period of time. So there's, it sort of evolves. And of course, there are events. There's a day when, a precise day when I become CEO. There's a time when it's announced. You know, those are very sort of specific things. But if you stand back a little bit further away from that, it's simply the way the relationship evolved. And it was pretty deliberate in a way. You know, the European thing, go moonlight in Europe so you can learn something about operations. Let's figure out how we're gonna work this way together. And even after that formal transition, he remains chairman of the board and very active in our business and a real mentor and partner, both, to me until today. I never stepped in thinking I'm going to try and be the next Bill Marriott. That would be foolish. This was in many respects, a founder of the company. His dad and mom were founders, but Bill is the founder of the hotel business, which is obviously the only thing we do today. And he dramatically grew it, and has an impact which is obviously profound on the company and the industry. And for me, I just step in and say, okay, well, I'm the guy who follows him. I'm not the guy who's going to try and be him. And do the best I can to make sure we are maintaining the culture that has taken us this far. Make sure, hopefully, we're building on it, and at all costs, try not to screw it up.
So you've got the wheels to this great automobile, many of which he has in his garage. But so this is an opportunity that came about. And I think the Starwood opportunity is one that's interesting just because of how it evolved. It never became something that was clear and obvious until 2014, when there was this big delta between valuation companies. So you took over in 2012, and this is a couple years out. Just let's walk through what happened, how did this become interesting, and then the what's happening inside the boardroom, the discussions and the conversations.
So remember, I start really in the M&A area at Marriott, and throughout, after becoming CFO, remain quite interested in what could we buy, what should we buy, what kind of transactions should we be doing. And over that period of time, we watch Starwood get built, in effect. We didn't buy Westin. Starwood Capital buys Westin. Starwood Hotels buys Westin. And putting together Westin and Sheraton and the real estate they have, they start to create one of our principal competitors. But as they create it, we watch it periodically over those times and say, okay, is this something that we should be interested in acquiring? And of course, it was never for sale, for one thing. And then you've got the questions of both value and strategy, which go into that calculation. We get into early 2015. Let me think about this for a second. Let's see if I can do this math right. Early 2015, and Starwood, in effect, puts itself up for sale. That by itself is maybe the biggest factor here. Because unless a company puts itself up for sale, no matter how much you want to buy it, it's going to be a difficult thing to try and accomplish. That comes out. We look at it. I talked to Barry Sternlicht on the phone from in front of my house one evening and say, well, are you looking at it? Should we look at it together? What do you want to do? And we both sort of say, it's damn expensive. And I'm not sure it makes sense to jump in. And so we ultimately look at it, sort of say, let's not do it. Communicate that with the board at whatever the next meeting is. We've looked at it, we've decided to pass. I think that was our May board meeting. By the time, let me think about this for a second, by the time we get to August, no, it's October. It's the October board meeting. As we're approaching the October board meeting, we decide, you know what, we maybe ought to jump in now, because the stocks have continued to move, it's one thing, so the economics have gotten better. The second thing is that those intervening 4 or 5 months, we've spent a lot of time negotiating with or watching technology disruptors in our industry. We have a very intense negotiation with Expedia over the course of those months, almost going dark on the Expedia platform because of the way those negotiations went. I visited Google, I visited Facebook, I visited Alibaba. Coincidentally, it had nothing to do with Starwood, but all of this stuff is sort of churning, and it's becoming apparent to us that being bigger is an advantage. And again, the economics have gotten better and better. And so I put a call into the chairman of Starwood on a Friday afternoon and say, I think we're interested in acquiring the company. And there's silence on the other end of the phone. This is Bruce Duncan. Silence on the other end of the phone. And I said, Bruce, if I were you, I would ask me why you should believe me, given that we looked at this and said we're not interested before. He said, yeah, okay, that's a good question. And I gave him the answer and basically outlined the both evaluation and structure of a deal I thought we could do. And then there was again silence on the other end of the phone. I said, don't feel like you got to answer now. Get off the phone, get with your bankers and your lawyers, and figure out what you want to do. And of course that happened by the next morning. We have heard, okay, we're interested, let's go. It was well rumored at that time, and of course since there's been lots of disclosure, but I think Hyatt was within moments of closing that or binding that deal, and if we had waited another week, we might well have lost the opportunity to jump in. We then have, of course, the next board meeting, and the board says, wait a second, you told us you weren't interested in this, and now suddenly you're interested. What's the story? And of course, Mr. Marriott is also deeply interested in this. We were together that weekend, actually, right after the call I made. And I called Mr. Marriott on Monday and said, I've just had this call, and I think we should take a look at this. And I said, don't say anything, right? Because you don't know enough to react. And I don't know enough to even tell you this is something we should definitively do. I know it's compelling enough, we should take a look at it. Let us do the work this week, let us come up with a model, let us sit with you in person and explain why this is something that we ought to move on. That happens a few days later, and going into that meeting, I don't know whether he's gonna say, are you nuts? Or this is something we should do. And we took him through it and he said, this is compelling, let's go.
Having the love and support of those around us really is the most important thing. And I think that, Arne, the professional journey that you've had, you know, really represents that, you know, when you believe in people and you kind of build those relationships, that good things happen, you know, and the outcome is that the revenues of the business from when you took over, I think, you know, in 2012, it was $11.8 billion. You finished last year at $22 billion. But I think more than any of that, which is, you know, what we can call it, get our hands around, is really the love and support that you've had at home. And so I think some of the best times that we've had is when Ruth and you and Reshma and I can talk about our families, our kids, their journeys. Can talk a little bit about, you know, this picture right here, you know, this couple that has been together, has built this incredible family together, these great kids. I love the story of how close the kids are, kind of the rule you and Ruth kind of gave them about, you know, being together, and just encapsulate kind of this, the most important thing that I think we can talk about.
Yeah, I love seeing these pictures. These are much easier to look at than those 35-year-old college pictures or 40-year-old college pictures. Although, I guess when I had bad hair 40 years ago, it's now matched by my boys with their bad hair today. Ruth and I we've been together for 34 years this year, she's a great partner and a great friend, and of course the mother of these four now adult children, and we love each other and hang together all the time. the picture, the left is the two of us heading up Kilimanjaro. The kids were on the trip with us too. I don't know how we lost them for this photo, but it is that we've traveled a lot together. It is the trip that the kids would say is hands down the best. In part just because you're accomplishing something together. You're together all the time. It's 7 days up, 2 days down, or a day and a half down. And everybody gets altitude sickness in one way or another, so there's an exhaustion to it. But you're helping each other up. You're a team in many respects. And it was a really fabulous time. They remain really close. Three of them live in New York and one in Washington. And the rule you were talking about, we said years ago, partly as a way of sort of bribing them to be close, we said, whenever the four of you are alone, nobody else, and go out to dinner, we'll pay for it. Fortunately, not all four live in New York, otherwise we'd probably be buying them dinner all the time. But it's not because of that rule, but in a sense, because of the relationship that they've had with each other. Two of them live together, they're great, great friends, and they are today not just close to us, but they're great millennial advisors to me. They are merciless with their criticism at times. They say, "Dad, what you're you know, whatever is the dumbest thing I've ever seen. Why are you doing that?" But they do it always with love and always with a effort to make me do a better job. They take as much pride in what I do as I take in what they do.
I know you've said that being a father is truly the most important thing that you've ever done and will continue to do. I think that's the case for so many of us. But with your travel schedule, with what you've done, on a professional basis, I know how critically important that time is at home. Your father, did the same in terms of his travel. In closing, in terms of thinking about this, faith runs very deep in your family. So if you really do think about the importance of what we see here, these beautiful smiles, this incredibly happy family, where you came from, what is it that you hope that dad thinks as he sees this?
Yeah, it'd be great if he were still alive. He's been gone for far too many years. He was an obnoxiously proud father of all of his kids. I think he would certainly be proud. I think at the same time, he would put less value in the position that I hold today than in a picture like this, the family. It's never been about how much money you make or how much stature you have, but it's a question of, okay, what kind of life are you leading? By the way, I'm a long way from leading as good a life as I'd like to leave, as meaningful a life as I'd like to lead. But it is about how are you engaged with each other? How are you engaged in the community? How are you engaged with the people that you interact with on a daily basis? This is not really what you asked, but when all of us in this room are either really hard workers, or if we're at Georgia State or other schools, we're about to become really hard workers, and that's okay. But the thing that we forget and is at threat today is when we're together, too often we're not really together. We've got these devices in our pockets which are tempting to take out all the time. And so here you finally got a day or a weekend together and you're distracted by the devices and the stuff that is happening. For any decent relationship with a spouse, with a child, with a friend, that's the kiss of death, the absolute kiss of death. One of the reasons this guy is such a fabulous guy is he knows everybody in the industry, by the way, but he cares about these relationships and is very deliberate about saying, how are you? How's your family? What's going on? It's a great lesson for all of us. Put the damn device away and be with the people that you're with.
Be present.
Be present.
I know that they'd be very proud of you as as we all are, and I'm grateful to be your friend.
Well, thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Arne Sorenson.
Thank you, everybody.
Thanks.
Mr. Sorenson, surrounded by students, undergrad hospitality students, graduate students, faculty, staff, we would like to thank you for telling us your story this afternoon so openly and sincerely. We appreciate your being such a stellar leader, serving as a role model for our future leaders and for all of us in this room and more. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Give a round of applause for Mr. Arne Sorenson, Mitch Shaw, Dr. and Mrs. Shaw. Thank you for making this afternoon, this program possible. Thank you.